It is an honor and a privilege to worship and fellowship in a church that holds the Bible in such high regard and esteems it so highly, and the Bible is their first and only authority. So I'm so thankful for that. And it is a privilege to have you here and share this moment with me, David. Thank you so much. You've had a huge impact on my life, and especially my life in Christ. And it is also a privilege and an honor to share my testimony. And more importantly, it's an honor and a privilege to proclaim Christ and Him crucified in front of you all. So I am very thankful for that. And my prayer is that my story will give the saints encouragement and courage. And it also is my prayer that those of you who have not answered that question of when Jesus asks, you know, who do you say I am? It is my prayer that if you haven't answered that question, that my story convicts you and perhaps creates some fissures in that stony wall that you've created to block the work of the Holy Spirit. Some 12 years ago, more or less, the Holy Spirit crushed my heart. And I am so thankful that he stole me, or not stole me, but grabbed me out of that fire. I was involved in a tumultuous relationship for a number of years. I mean, we had it all. We had domestic abuse, we had substance abuse, verbal abuse, emotional abuse, adultery. We had it all, and I certainly didn't know how to handle that. I had no tools on how to deal with that. I thought I tried it all. I tried yelling. I tried counseling, numerous counselors, Christian counselors, counselors that asked me, you know, what kind of cat would you say you are? You know, that's how depraved and how desperate you get. And I certainly tried the silent treatment, days and days on end, saying nothing to these people that I said that I loved. And in fact, I was so lost and so bewildered, and at the end of myself, I even tried the silent treatment with yelling. I mean, that's how ridiculous it was. And I came to the end of myself. I had no answers. There was nothing that I could do. I'd work all day and try to stay at work as long as I possibly could in hopes that when I came home that I would respond differently. But I couldn't. Every day after day. And it was the same response. Sooner or later, you know, that anger would boil up in me. And he finally crushed me. He brought me to the point where I had no answers. And I realized it. I realized that the things that I was doing were making it even worse. And in fact, I got to the point where I felt justified in doing the horrible things that I did. And I'm not proud of those things. I'm so thankful that those things are so far, far away from me. But in some regard, I am thankful that he brought me to that place. And as Pastor Pat is gonna preach on later, I had worldly grief. I had worldly grief, and I suffered, and I moaned, and I mourned for days and days and days, perhaps even years. And I came to Christ thinking that He was going to solve my problems. I was looking for a solution for my worldly problems, and I was aware of it. I was aware that I had problems, and that's about as far as it took me until one day I can vividly remember working out in a wide open field, and he just literally brought me to my knees, and he said, "What are you going to do? What are you going to do about your sin?" And I had no response. And that's the godly grief that he gave me. that he brought that sin right in front of me as long as I tried to fight it off, and as long as I tried to hold on to that sin so much, I had no response. I had none of us have a response of what we're going to do with our sin. And I was that prodigal son. I ate at that trough with the pigs, and I loved it. I loved it, and I couldn't get enough. And then, just like the prodigal son, he brought me to reasoning. He brought me to a sense of, dude, you're eating pig slop. That's not what you're supposed to be doing. And I ran back to the Father. I ran back humbly on my knees, and I cried out to him. And I'm hopeful that you people that haven't proclaimed as Lord and Savior in your life, that you're prepared and you're preparing yourself to do that. Because you need to get on your knees. Because we all enter the kingdom. We all enter the kingdom humbly, poor in spirit, mourning our sins. And I'm hopeful that happens to you soon. I'm hopeful that even happens to you today. Because I was standing at the precipice. I was standing at the cliff of damnation. And if you haven't proclaimed Christ as your Savior, that's exactly where you're standing. And you have no solution. You have no response to that. So since then, it has gone beyond the realization of my sin and the conviction of my sin. And it came to repentance. And I fully repented. And as we're going to learn a lot more about repentance later on. And Pat, I did not know what you were going to preach on, so I don't mean to be stealing any of your thunder in regards to repentance, but that's part of my story. And a repentance is, it's not only, it's much more than just changing our mind. It's changing how we see sin. It's changing our response to sin. It's changing how we perceive each other. It changes how we look at each other. It changes our aspirations, our desires, our wills. It changes everything in your life. And I am so thankful that I was brought to that I was crushed and I was brought to that point. I feel so blessed and honored for that, for the wretch that I was, that he's given me salvation. And I am thankful for this t-shirt that I get from Sailorville. But I know on that day of reckoning, I know on that day of salvation, I'm going to get much more than a t-shirt. I'm going to get a crown of glory. So for that, I am thankful. And I hope that, and I wish that, and I pray that for you too. That you trade in those dung-ridden clothes that you're wearing, your dung-ridden righteousness, and you trade it in for a crown of glory.
Thank you, Daniel. And there is an importance in our name, Daniel. God is my judge. He's a personal judge. And on that day in the field when he brought you to your knees, can you tell us a little bit more about what happened at that time?
Oh, boy, I didn't realize there was going to be a quiz, Dave. But, well, I mean, the turmoil went on for years, and I had no response, and it was, let alone frustrating, but you really come to the end, and all your energy is sapped, all your literally, you have no idea what to think and what to say or what to do, and a lot of tears. It was just, I couldn't even see what I was doing. I was crying so much. It was just a lot of tears. I had nothing. I had nothing left. I came, as Jesus said, blessed are those who are poor in spirit. I had nothing. I was completely bankrupt.
And you sense that he fully came into your life?
Oh, absolutely.
And saved you?
Yeah, absolutely. He literally grabbed me out of the fire.
Thank you. Thank you. Let me pray for you. Father, I thank you for Dan. I do thank you, Lord, for crushing him. As you have, Lord, you say either we'll fall at your feet or you'll crush us, Lord. And so I thank you, Lord, that you have done that to Dan. I am excited about what you have planned for him, or I do pray that you would be glorified in him, that he would sense your presence, that he would continue to repent and continue to reach out to you, Lord, and to grow in you. I thank you for this chance to be with him in this time and to baptize him. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
Daniel, based on your testimony of salvation, get your other arm up here. I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.